We're going to move on to the next talk in the session then. This is going to be on operational considerations, scheduling, and insurance. And we're going to have speakers Stacey Friedel, Nicole Frost, and La’Tai Jenkins talk to us. As you can see, this is a multidisciplinary group. Stacey is an occupational therapist, and she's a team lead at the Comprehensive Inpatient Rehabilitation Program at Johns Hopkins Hospital. Nicole Frost is a speech and language pathologist, and she's an acute care therapy services team lead at Johns Hopkins Hospital. And La’Tai Jenkins is a physical therapist, and she's the stroke program navigator and a clinical resource analyst at Johns Hopkins Hospital. So thank you very much, and the floor is yours.
Hi, everyone. So for this part of the course, we're going to talk about the operational redesign to help to facilitate the continuum of care in stroke recovery. There we go. So disclosures, we don't have any disclosures except that we receive salary from the Johns Hopkins Hospital. So objectives overall, we're just going to talk about how we really operationalize the changes to new delivery of care models across acute care, acute rehab, and outpatient. So to start, we'll start with acute care. So on the acute care side, when we had the opportunity to change our rehabilitation approach in acute care, our team decided that we wanted to review the current therapy model. And the first step was really to identify the team or the members involved. So this included physical therapists, occupational therapists, speech language pathologists, physiatrists, neurologists, and nurses. And all of the staff had a number of years working with patients in stroke in the acute care setting and had a passion for improving rehabilitation for patients following stroke. So each of the team members reviewed the literature on rehabilitation following stroke with a focus on the acute care setting. And overall, we found limited literature on timing, frequency, and duration of rehabilitation sessions during the first few days following stroke, especially within the first 7 days. As a team, we felt the limited literature available appeared to support initiating therapy in the acute care setting when providing short, frequent therapy sessions. So to align our delivery of care model with this idea, our team decided to develop a new delivery of care model, increasing the frequency of the sessions, but decreasing the duration of the sessions. So this new delivery of care model provided patients with up to 2 therapy sessions per discipline per day. So, and this was done 6 days per week. And the literature review also included a review of evidence-based treatment strategies, focusing on mobility, neuroreeducation, activities of daily living, vision, cognition, speech, language, and swallowing. And we tended to find that the more traditional therapy model provided in acute care tended to focus on compensation. However, the literature was really focusing on neurorehabilitation and neurorecovery, demonstrating the importance of focusing on rehabilitation with a focus on both impairment and function. Therefore, we decided to encourage our team to provide 1 impairment-based session and 1 function-based session. And of course, this is always titrated based on the patient's individual needs and medical stability. For SLP, we took it one step further, as many acute care settings focus primarily on swallowing. And what speech did is we encouraged them to complete 1 swallowing session per day, but then their other session to focus on either language, cognition, or motor speech to make sure we were addressing all of the patient's current deficits. Following discussions with the neurology team, we determined that there was the average number of stroke patients that were admitted to the acute care hospital at one time was about 15 patients. So as this new delivery of care model included an increased frequency of therapy, we knew that we would need to modify therapy staffing. So in order to do this, and in order to provide up to 2 30-minute treatment sessions per discipline per day for about 15 patients, we knew that we would likely need 3 physical therapists, 3 occupational therapists, and 3 SLPs to be adequately staffed to provide this level of treatment. So it is important to note that to meet the staffing model, we did not increase the number of therapists within the department, but instead reallocated resources. And we did this by making sure that we are evaluating and treating the right patient at the right time across the entire acute care setting, as Dr. Pruski mentioned during yesterday's panel. And because this was a big change to the typical delivery of care in acute care, we felt that consistent therapists would be beneficial. Therefore, a small group of therapists that were assigned to the stroke service. And all of the therapists assigned to the stroke service had experience with providing evaluation and treatment to patients with neurologic diagnoses. And we actually sat down and asked our team for feedback on what they would want their preferred work schedule to look like in this new delivery of care model. And there were 3 options that we provided. And the team voted and decided on 4 10-hour shifts per week with a set day off each week. And for weekend coverage, the decision was made to rotate these weekend dates. So each therapist was assigned every 3rd weekend date. So once we developed the new delivery of care model, we then moved on to the day-to-day details. So in order for therapy to evaluate and treat patients, we of course require therapy orders placed by the medical team. And these orders are typically placed on admission based on the patient's presentation as well as the confirmed stroke location. And the decision regarding the need for therapy orders is made by the neurology team. So we do not have blanket order sets that result in PT, OT, and SLP orders for all stroke patients, as we felt it was important to remain patient-centered and continue with our model of evaluating the right patient at the right time. However, if the patient was admitted to the floor and nursing thought that the patient may benefit from a specific therapy that was not ordered, they could talk to the neurology team about that. And therapy was also able to do that as well. So if there was a patient that maybe physical therapy saw, and they felt that the patient would benefit from a speech language pathology consult, that was a conversation that easily happens between the therapy team and the neurology team. And as I mentioned on the previous slide, we decided to provide up to 2 sessions per discipline per day, 6 days a week. Therefore, the maximum number of sessions that a patient may participate in a given day is 6. Monday through Friday. However, again, this is titrated and based on what the patient is able to tolerate and the patient's medical stability. And in order to organize the multiple therapy sessions per day, we decided to create a daily schedule similar to an acute rehab setting. So we thought this would help us to improve communication between therapy disciplines, as well as to improve communication with nursing and the medical teams. This also helped to make sure we were consistent with the literature by only providing short sessions throughout the day. And based on the 10-hour shift schedule, we were able to create 45-minute time blocks in the morning sessions and 30-minute time blocks in the afternoon sessions. And the 45-minute time slots in the morning, the expectation was not to see the patient or treat the patient for 45 minutes. This was to allow for about a 15 to 30-minute therapy session based on the patient's current needs, as well as time for the therapist to do a chart review and documentation. And because the patients were seen twice a day by each discipline, the afternoon session for the patient was typically completed by the same PT or OT or SLP staff that had worked with the patient in the morning. Therefore, we felt a 30-minute time block was appropriate at the chart review, and as the chart review and the discussion with the nurse would only include details that would have or changes that would have occurred since the morning session. And then we also had to collaborate with other departments outside of physical medicine and rehab and neurology, specifically when completing instrumental swallow studies. So we met with radiology and perioperative services to discuss a strategy for scheduling video fluoroscopic swallowing studies, also known as modified barium swallow studies, as well as fiber optic endoscopic evaluation of swallowing studies or FEES. And based on these discussions, we decided to have set times for the VFSS and the FEES. So for example, if a patient is on the stroke service and was recommended for a VFSS, this patient is consistently placed on the radiology schedule at 3 p.m. So this allowed for clear communication and expectations for speech, radiology, nursing, and the medical team. And then for weekends, we decided to have a stroke-specific physical therapist here on Saturday and a stroke-specific SLP and OT here on Sunday. And the patients are seen for up to one PT session on Saturday and up to one OT session and one SLP session on Sunday. And when creating the schedule, each morning, the lead therapist or the therapist covering for the lead therapist creates the schedule for all of the staff for PT, OT, and SLP. And this schedule is then provided to the stroke team and is also placed in the nurse's station. So this allows for nursing and the medical team to be aware of when therapy visits are scheduled. And if there are pre-scheduled appointments or family meetings, the therapist scheduling the appointments or therapy visits for the day are able to work around those things. And it is also important to note that we are a research institution. Therefore, there are times when a patient has consented to participate in a research study. So the team members of any active IRB approved research study that may include acute stroke patients are also provided with the therapy schedule. And this allows them to identify the times when the patient may be available during the day so that the research involvement does not impact the new standard of care. And I do think it's important to note that while the schedule is made each day all team members try to follow the schedule, there are absolutely times when we deviate from the schedule. Because the patients that we're treating, the acute stroke patients, are in the neurocritical care unit and on the acute care floors, the patient may be off the floor for testing or a procedure like an MRI or an echo. So we are absolutely able to deviate from the schedule as those things occur and see a different patient at a different time. Additionally, while patients may be scheduled for up to 6 therapy sessions per day, that is not always the case. And not every patient always gets 6 therapy sessions per day. So it's not like we have to try to make it up later on if the patient was off the floor for MRI earlier that day. So for example, if a patient has a decline in medical status or the patient's not medically stable to participate in a therapy session based on the therapist's discussion with the multidisciplinary team, then the session is just not completed. So this is just an example of one of the schedules, and this is just a piece of it. So the room numbers are listed along the left side, and there are notes for the schedulers that help. So it could be that the patient benefits from a rehab tech, or that the patient may benefit from going to the therapy gym, or for patients that don't need all three disciplines, maybe they just need to see SLP, then that is listed there in the notes. And then the time blocks are listed across the top. So 45-minute sessions in the morning and 30-minute sessions in the afternoon. And like I mentioned, this is just an example. In our situation, because the shifts are 10 hours, the session times ranged from 7:15 a.m. to 6 p.m. And then moving on to our rehabilitation huddle, which I think is a really unique and very valuable addition to this new stroke rehab model. So the rehab huddle occurs Monday through Friday for about 15 minutes. Ours is scheduled at 11:45 in the morning. And the PT, the OT, SLP, and physiatry staff all attend. And each patient is briefly discussed with a focus on 4 specific topics. So this includes barriers to progress in therapy sessions, any barriers to discharge, the most effective strategies that can be utilized during therapy sessions, and an overall rehabilitation discharge recommendation. So regarding barriers to progress, an example would be maybe concerns regarding reduced engagement and potential depression. So if this was a concern, the team would reach out to the neurology team and express these observations, as well as discuss the potential benefit of a neuropsych consult. When talking about barriers to discharge, this may be a plan for an oral diet versus alternate nutrition. When discussing effective strategies for the session, this may vary based on the patient's current strengths. So for example, we may be talking about the best way to communicate with a patient who has a new receptive aphasia. And then when talking about the discharge recommendation, PT, OT, SLP, and physiatry are all involved in the discussion and have the opportunity to state their preferred recommendations as well as their rationale. And after all the team members have provided their input, all members of the huddle identify one discharge recommendation based on the patient's overall rehab needs. And the discharge recommendation is then the physical medicine and rehab's discharge recommendation. And this is communicated to care management, nursing, and the neurology team. And then lastly, how did we roll this all out? So the official start date for this new delivery of care model in acute care was January 7th, 2019. And for the first 6 months, we collected quality improvement data to identify barriers and potential safety concerns related to this new delivery of care model. We also collected the number of attempted visits and the reasons for those attempted visits. And each month we met with all of the PT, OT, SLP, and physiatry team members to get feedback on what was going well and what could be improved. And we discussed barriers and potential solutions. So based on feedback from the staff, we did make modifications to the schedule as well as invested in additional equipment and resources. So for example, based on the feedback from our staff level therapists, they felt it was difficult to efficiently document the second visit note due to the need to repeat a lot of the same information listed in the initial visit note. Therefore, we worked with our electronic medical record team and created a second visit note that helped to reduce the documentation time and the requirements. We also received feedback that it was sometimes difficult to quickly determine if a specific type of session or evaluation was required, like the need for a standardized cognitive evaluation. So to address this barrier, we created a key or a code on the schedule that would help to clearly identify any important information for the session and or the need for a standardized assessment. We also use that to help identify when we may maybe the patient would benefit from a rehabilitation tech. Additionally, as the therapists were now providing more treatment sessions compared to typical acute care practice, the therapists identified the need for additional equipment and resources to continue to provide high quality evidence-based treatment. So these items were purchased and then organized and placed in areas that were easily accessible to the therapist during the therapy sessions. So during the first 6 months, the PM&R team also provided education to the multidisciplinary team on the new treatment model, as well as the scope of practice for each discipline. So for example, the neurocritical care unit was not accustomed to SLP providing language and cognitive treatment in the ICU. So it was also often assumed that SLP was attempting to see the patient for swallowing. So our team was able to provide education on the potential benefits of initiating this type of intervention in the ICU. And lastly, the number of attempts and reasons for attempts were found to be consistent with the typical standard of care prior to this new delivery of care model in the acute care setting. And there were no major safety concerns related to the new delivery of care model. So all of the staff members' concerns and barriers were addressed within the first 6 months. And we then shifted the operational focus to identifying and implementing the standard outcome measures, which Peiting just discussed earlier. So overall, it's important to mention that while this approach has worked at JHH, your facility may have different patient profiles of stroke patients, and therefore modifications to this enhanced stroke model may be necessary to meet the needs of your patients in your facility. Personally, I feel like the most important pieces of the new model in acute care were the transitions to a focus on treatment and intervention, the focus on multidisciplinary communication and collaboration, and the titrating of therapy based on the individual patient's needs and medical status. And with that, I'm going to move over and introduce Stacey, who is going to talk about the inpatient rehab model.
This is our smooth transition of care here. So for inpatient rehab operations, our team, in collaboration with the acute care team, reviewed the current literature to help guide updates to our delivery of care model. The team also reviewed the guidelines for adult stroke rehab and recovery to ensure we are aware of the guidelines and ensure they were being addressed as part of care on the inpatient rehab unit. We wanted to know the impact of striving for additional time on task for our patients. So we first needed to start with who are our patients, because we're a general rehab unit, not a stroke unit. In review of the uniform data system reports, which is every inpatient rehab facility, CARF accredited in the United States, uses them for data system reporting. We looked at our case mix. How many of our patients were in the stroke impairment group? Over the past 5 years, we were always under 25%. As low as 16%, as high as 23%. So we were like, okay, we think we can do this. It's not every patient. So we also looked at the day-to-day, like how many patients were we actually going to deliver this extra therapy to? And it was only about 3 to 5 patients on census on average. We're only a small 18-bed inpatient rehab unit. We also wanted to know whether our patients were coming from Nicole's team. So were they already going to have some functional measures completed? Were they all already going to be in the system, or were they coming from external hospitals? So initially it seemed like we had more internal, but over time we had a lot of external. Obviously COVID played a role with that as well. Let's see. So For example, if they were coming from acute care, we wouldn't really have to readminister some of the testing, which was a real change of practice for us. So a patient who needed speech therapy may have an R-bands on acute care, and then we would act like they were a new patient and we would administer another R-bands. I'm sure there's a different version. I'm not a speech therapist, but say we would give the R-bands B. But really we found there was really no reason to give a similar assessment. We would just add on with a different assessment, like the CLQT. So that really saved time and we could get right to treatment faster. We also, the results were in the EMR and it was a lot more streamlined on how we could view those. So that was to help us quickly assess that or access that information to develop our goals and our treatment plans. One concern we also had, incorporating more of an impairment-based approach with the same amount of resources, was the impact on length of stay and our quality indicator gains. Would putting a greater focus on impairment increase our length of stay? Team members were concerned, would patients not be able to function in the home setting when they had a discharge from rehab? Would the measures we are benchmarked against be impacted by making attempts to offer more impairment-based therapy? Inpatient rehab facilities are not reimbursed based on impairment gains at this time. The measures are function-based. Again, these are just concerns we had. We did not have the resources to research this, just questions staff or administration may ask. Luckily, our unit already functioned below the national benchmark for length of stay. So the slight increase we observed was not a concern for administration. Inpatient rehab values the interdisciplinary team approach. So of course, collaboration with all disciplines was important. One example of collaboration is the development of interdisciplinary team goals. We developed the goals during their team meeting. They're posted in the patient's room. And the team goals are anything more than one discipline can be working on. So ideally, these goals are, team members come together knowing the patient's goals, and they're driven by the patient. A goal could be something as simple as walking to the bathroom. And all team members knowing that goal, this will help the patient progress throughout the 24-hour day. That way you don't have the 7 o'clock person coming in and using a bedpan or a bedside commode when the patient can clearly walk to the bathroom, and that's the goal. In terms of our staffing, we had no notable changes in our staffing model. Therapy orders, I think Nicole covered that quite well. We are, PT and OT pretty much is standard for all our patients, and that's based on mainly a CMS requirement that patients have to have two billable disciplines to be on inpatient rehab. But many of our patients that are being admitted with the diagnosis of stroke also do need speech. We do request recreational therapy orders from our physicians. We are a small unit, so we only have one recreational therapist. Her time is precious, so we want to make sure she's seeing the correct patients. So we just want to make sure when we meet the patients, we think they can tolerate, the additional discipline and they're willing to participate in that discipline, which would be recreational therapy. In terms of scheduling, first we had to know who the stroke patients were, as our goal was to schedule them for additional time. With that, the time being focused on impairment, typically limb impairment. So the additional time would go to PT or OT. However, after the initial evaluations were completed, or really any time in the patient's stay, that could change. If the patients had more upper limb involvement, they may get more OT. If the patient had more swallowing concerns, they may get more speech, always individualized. We developed this simple diagram to know who our stroke patients were to meet our criteria. And what we really established were the 12-week mark. That was blessed by the physicians. So we really didn't have the resources to give additional time to more of the chronic strokes or if it was their secondary diagnosis and it was at that point chronic. We just used a little colorful brain symbol on our schedule board to indicate who the stroke patients were. This ensured all the schedulers knew that if they had a brain next to their name, that we wanted to offer additional therapy time to them when able. So since we did not increase our staffing and we didn't have a magic wand to offer more hours, we still had to find how we were going to do this. So every day, day by day, we looked at our available resources. How was staffing that day? Did we have a neuro PT resident on the service? Did we have a fellow for speech? Was someone being discharged and their 3 hours could be divided amongst the other patients, preferably with stroke? Was someone on medical hold and their 3 hours could go to a stroke patient? So we really just stayed on top of it, looking at it every day, ideally with the goal of giving that fourth hour. As mentioned, we also had recreational therapy to add to the mix, the fun therapy. We revamped our weekend scheduling with the goal of seeing patients with stroke for increased time, despite they had already received more than the required amount of therapy in the 5-day window that Medicare requires for our patients. We also instituted a huddle. Have my notes here, sorry. We did this over lunch, one time a week to discuss patients with stroke. We felt as though the one time a week timing for our patients was adequate based on our length of stay for stroke patients. This is in addition to the daily meeting required for inpatient rehab operations. So this mainly was more therapy driven. But as I believe Nicole also mentioned, we would touch base on barriers in therapy. We also would share tips. For example, you know, one therapist might find a way to get the patient to be able to, you know, reach more or do something different, and it would improve their function. So we would share those tips. Maybe we would have a patient who wasn't really motivated to participate, and another clinician found that if you play jazz music, that they would be more alert and more participatory. So we would share those things in the huddle. We also created in-room activity programs. They're similar to what everyone calls an HEP, but their room in the hospital isn't their home, and not everyone likes to exercise. So we wanted to get rid of those two words. Our goal was to be creative with the in-room activity programs. We would use the technology, but it might be as simple as having the patient sing a song, play a card game, and exercise too, if that was their thing, whatever motivated them. And this was outside of therapy hours. Developed by the therapist, but we did rely on our rehab technicians and family to carry out the in-room activity programs. This was not part of their scheduled 3 to 4 hours of care. And from a safety standpoint, we did always do them seated, as the caregivers administering them were concerned about. During the huddle, it was also a checkpoint for our functional outcome measure completion. The facilitator of the huddle ensured the measures were completed. If not, as a group, we discussed barriers to completion. Team recommendations were also made for the next level of care based on patients' rehab needs using the algorithm, which I'll review next, and we would initiate communication based on that recommendation. So here's an example of the algorithm that was developed. It was designed to identify the lower level patients. I think Preeti did a pretty good job of explaining this earlier, but the patients that would benefit, what would they benefit from in the outpatient setting? The inpatient rehab team would discuss the appropriateness of patients during the huddle, and we'd actually give them a number in order to make our recommendation. What we found though over time was that many of our patients, as Preeti mentioned, would benefit from high intensity, but based on support, transportation, and finances, the recommendation needed to change. If you don't have anyone to help you get in the car, you're probably not going to get to outpatient every day. Okay, and lastly, our rollout. A big part of it was education. This isn't specific to inpatient operations, but as a department, we created education modules. And gosh, I think there were 15 of them, but that included everything from foundational rehab concepts, motor learning, communication, swallowing, cognition, vision, all aligning with the ASA guidelines and the current evidence-based resources. But we wanted to make sure all of our staff had the same foundation and the same education related to patients with stroke. For the outcome measures, what Preeti has pretty much covered well, after we decided on which ones we were going to use, we really needed staff buy-in. The clinicians needed to be able to document those efficiently and incorporate those efficiently. So we had super users, champions, to work on education of the different clinicians to make sure that we were doing them consistently and that they were competent in doing those. And the team felt much more comfortable after that education. We also needed to ensure clinicians were aware of the treatment options they had, how to use the equipment, the new technology. So a lot of that education ongoing, but we always tried to create a champion or a super user in the different areas so we could ensure more comfort with the staff when they were using a new piece of equipment or technology. So we did things like the bimanual arm trainer, the mind pod, and then go training in all those areas. We also ongoing education with the interdisciplinary team. Maybe that patient that was going to be admitted who we all knew might not be able to make it home, why we weren't looking for a quick turnaround in their discharge or quickly sending them to subacute rehab. We were looking to be able to initiate some of these treatment options for them in our setting for these lower level patients. Nursing also was very involved. They added a advanced neuro assessment on our team. So nutrition was involved. They added different handouts for patients specific to stroke. So all team members were involved. Frequent communication was important. We wanted staff to have time to have their questions answered. You know, as you're changing your delivery of care, you want to make sure your staff is supported and they have the time to ask why we're doing this, how we're doing it, how it's impacting them. So we scheduled bi-monthly meetings with Dr. Raghavan, and we also incorporated it as an agenda item on our staff meeting. In addition, we tracked our ability to schedule the additional time given our resources, and we're in the progress of improving compliance with our functional outcome measure completion. So that's where we stand right now in inpatient rehab operations. And I'm going to send it over to La’Tai.
Thank you, Stacey. So I am just going to go through this rather quickly because we will expand on some of the operational changes that we had to make to deliver this new model of care in our session later when we talk about execution. But in outpatient, historically, as you've heard many times, the patients with the highest level of impairment, unfortunately, were getting the lowest level of therapy in the post-acute rehab options. And really, we were seeing that we needed to restructure an outpatient in a way that we could respond to this need for precision medicine. Because like most outpatient facilities, we did have a one size fits all cookie cutter two times a week for the majority of the patients. However, that was not going to fit for all patients. And then as Peiting and Preeti mentioned earlier, we designed these PATH programs. And so the high intensity five times a week, four times a week. So really, how are we going to restructure to be able to schedule those patients in that way? And just as Nicole and Stacey said, we really were doing this with the same level of staff, our neuro rehab therapists, who were being staffed in a number of other neuro rehab programs, not just stroke. So really it was an operational challenge to change this model and devote this amount of time to these patients that was needed and also respond to the increased volume that we were receiving for referrals because of the amazing job that Stacey and Nicole's team were doing with identifying appropriate patients and getting them referred over to us quickly. And I just thought that this study was kind of interesting that in addition to all of the challenges that we discussed in the current or the previous model of care, a lot of stroke survivors and families reported that they really had not a say in the post-acute options. If you've been on the floor, a lot of times the case manager will say, okay, like the team is recommending subacute. Here are the facilities that take your insurance. Which one would you like to go to? There's really not a lot of autonomy given to the patient and the family. So we really wanted to change that and to be more collaborative with not only the inpatient team, but also with our patients. Next slide, please. Can you go to the next slide? Okay, so the first challenge that we took on was the JSEP program, which you've heard a few times. And really, I consider this program to be a safety net. These are the patients that were discharging from acute care, from the brain recovery unit, who were considered to be high level. Nicole's team, PT, OT, and speech would do their initial evaluation and make their discharge recs. And these were the patients that had low level impairments and were felt that did not need to transition immediately to outpatient therapy. What's really amazing about this collaboration between PM&R and neurology was this really was brought about during COVID when almost all of our ambulatory visits at that time were being done via telehealth. So this JSEP program was the first fully telehealth multidisciplinary clinic for the institution. So it was no small feat. And really we wanted to make sure that the patients were progressing as anticipated and were safe. So they were looking at things like med management and cognition. And really when the patients returned for those visits, if either the neurology team, the therapy team, or the PM&R, the physiatry team identified lingering impairments, they would refer them to outpatient. So no patients were really falling through the cracks. So if you go to the next slide, what also happened with this program is we started the J-STEP education series that is, done in collaboration with neurology and PM&R and has rotating presenters. What was really awesome about this during COVID is that patients were invited and provided laptops or iPads to attend the stroke education series via Zoom right from their hospital bed. And so we really wanted to get them educated on lifestyle changes and get patients and caregivers, families, questions answered before they were discharged so that they could start to implement some changes at home. And so next slide. And so I'm sorry that this is a little blurry to read, but what I think it illustrates really well is that to make a change in the delivery of care, especially inpatient to outpatient, it really required that care coordination of so many different providers and departments, entities. What you see here is that, we really had to understand from start to finish or from admission to discharge and beyond, that there had to be coordination from the residents, the attendings, the stroke nurses, the therapists. We had to collaborate with compliance, informatics, and definitely access the schedulers, and really come up with an efficient process to not only identify the patients that would need these JSEP appointments, but also to get them scheduled and those appointments to be authorized by their insurance company. Next slide. We submitted this project as a poster presentation to the Armstrong Institute of patient safety and quality. Really what we wanted to do was decrease the cancellation and no-show rate of that JSTEP appointment. Again, this was started early on and had some challenges and then started again during COVID out of necessity to be able to see these patients and not be able to bring that many patients into the ambulatory setting. But at that time, telehealth visits were still not as frequent as they are now. There were a lot of patients who had never done a telehealth visit before. And then you combine that with maybe a motor cognitive or speech deficit, you can imagine that understanding that you are supposed to log on to just two visits, but there are going to be four providers, it was very confusing. And so we really did a root cause analysis and understood that a lot of the reasons that we were getting cancellations boiled down to our scheduling process, confusion among the patients, and then also that insurance authorization. And so we had set a goal to really work on those three main things and reduce that. And as you can see, we had in January 21, we instituted this action plan, and we immediately saw a decrease in the number of cancellation and no shows. And then you can see that it kind of backslid again. And what we learned from that was that we really needed to change some of these manual processes. Some things were, some communications were still happening via email, or we really needed to get a decision tree or get this built into our EMR and get a more automated system, and so that we could reduce that human factor or those manual errors. And so this particular endeavor, again, we presented that to the Armstrong Institute of Patient Health and Safety, and it was the 2021 winner of the Elizabeth A. Martinez Award for Innovation. Next slide. So you've seen this slide many times, but again, that was our challenge in outpatient. How do we identify these patients who have the highest level of impairment and give them an increased frequency of rehab? And then also, how do we coordinate that to make that easy so that they are coming in and they are getting PT, OT, speech with consistent providers on consistent days? And so really that was our charge. To not only to change our model of practice to be able to provide this, but also be able to provide it timely in that stroke recovery period that you know, so many have been talking about. Next slide, please. So one of the things that we quickly identified is that we needed to organize ourselves into care teams. And so you can see these care teams on the therapist template. This allowed us to do two things. Number one, along with the paths. So like Peiqing and Preeti explained, you know, we knew that a path A patient was going to be seen for a 4-week block and then be reassessed, and then maybe would continue on with therapy, maybe would not. But they were given that slot, that multi-D collaborative slot for that first 4 weeks. And then if they needed scheduling after that, they would move on into another scheduling process. But we made sure that we reserved that slot for that initial path A or path B plan of care. And so that way the patient had consistency among providers who they saw, they had consistency on the days that they were coming in, and we were able to provide back-to-back appointments. And we'll talk about later how that drastically increased our patient and staff satisfaction and decreased our cancellation and no-show rate. Next slide. So in discussion, you know, for all three of the levels of care that we presented today, you know, what seems to be a short amount of time, you know, about 2.5-3 years, we've radically changed, our inpatient and outpatient care plans, care coordination and scheduling models, really with the goal of meeting the patient where they're at. And I'll also add, you know, Hopkins, one of Hopkins' strategic goals is to make Hopkins easy. And, you know, many patients, especially patients and caregivers, if you've had a neurological injury, will say that getting care in any large institution is anything but easy. And so we really wanted to make that transition of care as seamless as possible as we could for the patient and their families. As Stacey touched on this a little bit, even in the best case scenario, there are patients who would be amazing for our program. However, there are factors such as finance, insurance, transportation, family dynamic, comorbidities, all kinds of things that impact, you know, our decision to accept someone into are path A or high frequency, or maybe we feel like it is more appropriate for them to do a path A or a more traditional route of therapy. And then lastly, you know, just as Nicole and Stacey had to reorganize their daily schedule, their teams, their staffing, Nicole talked about, you know, rescheduling their the times, they went to 10-hour days. We really had to figure out an outpatient how to strike a balance. So you saw on that previous slide that we had blocks or reserved slots for our SKSI specialty programs. But every reserve block on an outpatient schedule means that another patient cannot get in. It's literally a block. And so if a patient calls the call center and wants to get in, our call center is not able to schedule into those blocks. So there's always a balance of providing access for all of the other programs that Hopkins serves so well, but also wanting to make sure that we preserve our neuro rehab therapists for these patients and for the goals with changing over this to this model of care. So with that, I will stop and we can take any questions.
Thank you very much, La’Tai, Stacey, and Nicole. That was really great to hear how you managed to really put into place the vision and implement it and make it practical on a daily basis.